This is the fourth lecture of respiratory pharmacology record. Treatment of TB. As you know, treatment of TB varies from one country to another, and it is different from T prophylaxis because most of people have dormant TB inside the lung and elsewhere. But on losing immunity by, for example, diabetes, corticosteroids, AIDS, chronic liver and renal disease, now these dormant tubercle bacilli get flourished and cause disease itself. So many of the drugs I mentioned are used for not only for treatment, but rather for prophylaxis. But of course, the schedule is somewhat different from that in treatment. Now, in treatment of TB, we are usually accustomed to give combinations between three drugs. Sometimes, especially in developed countries, they may begin with two drugs in the first 3 months, but usually we begin with three rather than two drugs because we expect one of these drugs at least to be resistant. So commonly in the first 3 months of therapy we begin by three drugs and later can use only two drugs to be changed every 2 months for about 1 year. Not necessarily 1 year, but we have short courses of therapy, that is 9 months or even lower, and sometimes we give more longer therapy, for example, ameliorate cases and some advanced cases require even more than 1 year drug therapy. The aim of combination anti-tuberculous drugs is most important to decrease resistance. Because unfortunately, many of these drugs are used not only in treatment of TB, but in other bacterial diseases. So resistance is very likely to occur. To the extent that many companies are obliged to give combination of these drugs rather than simple drugs alone, so as to oblige physicians and consequently patients to use only these drugs in only in TB, but not in any other bacterial infection. Now, these drugs act by various mechanisms against tubercle bacilli, hence increasing the anti-tuberculous potency. And we can use low doses by each of these drugs in combination to minimize as much as we can toxicity, because this toxicity is very common due to prolonged use of these drugs, especially in some cases requiring more than 1 year's antitubercular therapy medication. We have first-line drugs, and these are the more potent and more specific and even less toxic antitubercular drugs and should be reserved for use in most cases unless there is any toxicity by one of these drugs or resistant development. Or sometimes we have particular problem in some patients. The first of these first-line drugs includes INH, isoniazid, or isonicotinic hydrazine. These are serotonins. First, the mechanism of this most important anti-tuberculous drug number one. It decreases senses of mycolic acid and thereby phospholipids of TB wall. This very important mechanism, that is, TB wall is very important for keeping integrity of tubercle bacilli. And so by disruption of this integrity of TB wall, the drug will be tuberculocidal. Now, tuberculocidal is very important in cases of low immunity, which is the usual case in patients with TB. And this in contrast with static drugs, because tuberculostatic drugs depend on the defense mechanism, immune mechanism of the patient. Because this drug acts on a specific TB wall component, that is mycolic acid, its spectrum involves only TB. And this is very good, unfortunately, to avoid its use in other bacterial infection, and thereby to decrease the likelihood of development of resistance. Accordingly, being specific for TB and being tuberculocidal and being of low resistance, the drug is potent again, and accordingly, it is given in most anti-tuberculous combined therapy. Pharmacokinetics of INH. To understand and break all these kinetic criteria, we should first know that it is lipophilic. And as you know, lipophilic drug cross lipoproteins. And all our membranes are lipoprotein in nature, whatever the cell may be. So a drug passing membrane of GIT can similarly pass blood-brain barrier centrally as well as liver cells. Accordingly, the pharmacokinetics of this INH includes, number one, regular absorption in GIT orally. So it can be given orally instead of parenteral, especially due to long-term therapy for patient compliance. Next, it passes blood-brain barrier. And as you know, one of the most dangerous complications of TB is TB meningitis. And so, being lipophilic, this drug can be effective in treatment of tuberculous meningitis. Thirdly, it passes to the liver to be metabolized. So by passing inside the liver cell, it can cause toxic effect, causing hepatotoxicity. Also, by this hepatic clearance, the dose can be changed and the half-life can be prolonged in liver dysfunction. So liver function can affect dose and half-life of isoniazid. In contrast, the drug being excreted as metabolized or changed by the kidney, it is unlikely to be toxic to the kidney. As well, it is not affected by renal function. So in renal dysfunction, changes of doses are not marked or less likely to occur. Uses. Because of the aforementioned criteria, INH can be used in almost all types of TB, including various types. Because being lipophilic, it can penetrate intracellular as well as extracellular tissues or cells. It can be effective in open lesion and as well in localized closed lesion, because it can pass all the membranes or barriers. So it is effective against fibrous forms of TB with excess fibrous tissue cover or envelope. Also with caseation, they can pass the caseous tissue, as well as I mentioned in TB meningitis, as well in TB affecting serous cavity, for example, pleural TB and peritoneal TB, which are not uncommon. This is in treatment, but It is also used not only in treatment, but also in prophylactic. And as we know nowadays, there is a large tendency to use prophylactic anti-tuberculous drugs in patients with low immunity because of likelihood of development of TB very soon, especially, for example, in AIDS, in diabetic sometimes, patient corticosteroid therapy, immunosuppressive, anti-cancer drugs, patients with autoimmune diseases with consequent drug therapy. In some of these cases, anti-tuberculous drugs, special INH, are given beforehand, before the disease development. Of course, these drugs like INH used in prophylactic is used in lower doses, less frequently, and for shorter term therapy. Now, the adverse effects of INH. First of all, pharmacogenetic defect. We know that in the world, many patients are rabid acetylators. For example, in Asia, Japanese, and so on. Rabid acetylators represent, for example, as much as 90% or 95%. With slow incidence or presence of slow acetylators. In contrast, in Middle East, like Egypt, for example, and so on, most people are slow acetylators, representing more than 70%. 73 or 75% of people are slow acetylators. So this genetic defect can cause this adverse effect number one. That is to say, due to slow acetylation of INH, the metabolism is decreased or delayed. So INH will increase. Now, the increase of INH causing competition and consequent decreased effect of pyridoxine, which is vitamin B6. And as we know, vitamin B6 or pyridoxine is very important in nerve metabolism, that is for proper neuronal function, especially peripheral neural function. Pyridoxine is cofactor of many reactions, keeping integrity of the neurons. As well, pyridoxine is very important for GABA synthesis. Accordingly, by this pharmacogenetic defect, with decreased metabolism, this drug will be increased enough to cause deficiency of this B6. Accordingly, there will be polyneuropathy by deficiency of this vitamin B6 or pyridoxine peripherally, as well as centrally to cause decreased GABA, thereby increasing CNS stimulation. Because we know that GABA transmitter is the most important inhibitory transmitter in the brain. Accordingly, decreased GABA will be accompanied by CNS stimulation. And this may be very serious in some patients, especially those exposed to neuropsychiatric manifestations or diseases or even syndromes. Accordingly, treatment should be by pyridoxine in 100 milligrams. Why I specify this dose? Because if we increase the dose of pyridoxine above 100 milligrams, now pyridoxine will compete with INH or the drug itself, causing decrease its efficacy. So we should not increase pyridoxine dose more than 100 milligrams. Now, the second adverse effect occurs in slow acetylators. That is more in some for Japan and so on, but less in Middle East and so on. In these cases, due to rapid acetylation, due to rapid lipophilic action of INH, it may cause liver damage. And I put this liver damage as the second adverse effect in green color, because it is lipophilic. So whenever adverse effects is due to its lipophilic nature, I will write it in green color. So similarly, the adverse effects number 3, 4, and 5, that is green adverse effects, are due to lipophilic nature of isoniazid. First, bone marrow depression. This drug, because it is lipophilic, can pass membranes of bone marrow, causing depression. Either, for example, in leukocyte, agranulocytosis, in thrombocytes, causing thrombocytopenia, and RBCs forming cells, causing aplastic anemia. The fourth adverse effect due to lipophilicity is CNS manifestations. And as I mentioned, CNS stimulations occur secondary to decrease the inhibitory transmitter GABA. Fifthly, enzyme inhibitions also related to lipophilicity because it enters the liver cells to inhibit non-specific liver microsomal enzymes. This inhibition will enhance activity of other lipophilic drugs causing toxicity. So this is a serious interactions with other drugs sharing enzymes, liver microsomal enzymes by these drugs that is inhibiting liver microsomal non-specific enzymes. So there is increased drug toxicity, especially because this drug as well as other combined drug may be concomitantly used for TB or any other disease simultaneously. Now toxicity can result by this enzyme inhibition criteria. Sixthly, hemolytic anemia can occur in some patients, for example, liable to hemolysis by various gene pattern disturbance and so on, similar to some food causing hemolytic anemia and so on. Now, similar to most of the chemotherapeutic agents, antibiotics, hypersensitivity reactions can develop, but not serious, and it is not common. Lastly, resistance. Again, because this drug is used only in TB, resistance is less likely to develop compared to other anti-tuberculous drugs. Now the dose. The dose for patient compliance of this drug used for long-term therapy, it is 300 milligrams once daily only. But for more patient compliance and to avoid forgetting any dose and so on, we can give three times this dose, that is 900 milligram, twice weekly only. That is giving a similar dose, but divided by weekly, that is twice weekly instead of once daily for patient compliance, because many patients forget taking the dose, especially because they take different drugs at the same time. The second anti-tuberculous drug first line is rifampicin, also termed rifampicin, the same. Now, mechanism of this drug is via transcription inhibition. That is, we know that in the nucleus we have DNA, which forms messenger RNA by the DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And this is very important for initiation of various cell function. So by transcription inhibition, or this transcription inhibitor inhibiting DNA-dependent RNA polymerase, it will inhibit formation senses of messenger RNA from DNA. And as we know, messenger RNA will determine formation of all other cell constituents, causing severe cell damage, that is what we call tuberculocidal action. It is not written here, but you can write it. It is tuberculocidal, very important. It is bactericidal and tuberculicidal as well, because the drug being bactericidal, not necessarily being tuberculicidal, because sometimes tubercle bacilli are, of course, resistant, and sometimes they cannot be killed by some drugs, but others, and so on. Because bacteria are so simple compared to TB, which have other components, resistant development, and so on. Now, pharmacokinetics of rifampin is somewhat similar to isoniazid. That's completely absorbed due to its lipophilic nature, passing blood-brain barrier, effective immunogenesis, hepatic clearance, and so on. Possibly that's the same or similar to isoniazid. And as well, additionally, rifampin is excreted mainly in bile, that is via intrahepatic circulation. And this, as you know from pharmacokinetic in general, discussion in general pharmacology, it can prolong drug action number one and can lead to many interactions due to this criteria. And this is very important if we study in details interactions and so on of this rifampin or rifampicin, especially on prolonged usage. Now, regarding spectrum, unfortunately, it has broad spectrum activity against many cocci and many bacilli. This is, of course, unfortunately, because many physicians and even patients, but still without prescription of physicians, take rifampin in many bacterial infections, even tonsillitis, pharyngitis, upper respiratory tract infection, and so on. Especially in the preceding years before the development of new potent drugs in chemotherapy. That is to say, this rifampin was very commonly to be used in these diseases, and it was very potent, and as I mentioned, bactericidal, to extent that it was very commonly used, and many patients was having resistance, and many companies were obliged to use rifampin together with INH in the same preparations, so as to avoid its use in other bacterial infections and losing its activity as anti-TB drugs. Next, TB in tubercle bacilli and also in leprosy, even in viruses, because as I mentioned, it inhibits DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So it has broad spectrum activity, but when to be used, we should restrict its uses, not for the whole broad spectrum, but we should restrict the uses to only important life-saving diseases. So the uses of this drug, rifampin, includes all types or most types of TB, including, as I mentioned, fibrous open lesion and so on. Now I should clarify something to be considered either in INH or rifampin when saying all types of TB. It is actually, it may be all types, but to be more specific and accurate, I can say most types, because in some times it can be less effective. That is to say, in TB affecting renal tract, in TB affecting intestine, that is urinary TB and enteric TB. Why? Because by lipophilic nature of this drug, as well as isoniazid, it can pass membranes easily, and it is excreted in urine or renal tissue, changing, that is already metabolized. Of course, not all of it, but main part is metabolized. So it can reach the urinary tract mostly inactive. So its activity in renal types of TB is not as other types. Also, in TEREC TB, its effectiveness is less because of marked lipophilicity, and so it will pass GIT rapidly, so low concentrations are present in lumen of GIT, and so on. The second indication will be meningitis. And this is, of course, different from TB meningitis. It can be used in meningitis, whatever its cause organism may be, either meningococci causing meningococcal meningitis or Haemophilus influenza causing bacterial meningitis. The term bacterial meningitis is referred to, as you know, bacterial meningitis refers to Haemophilus influenza meningitis, and the term cerebrospinal meningitis is for convenience termed for meningococcal meningitis. And in these two cases, of course, it is effective because it is bactericidal as well as lipophilic with potent mechanisms. Not only it is used in meningitis treatment, but also for carrier, and is very important in TB as well as in meningitis. In both cases, in TB as treatment and also prophylaxis, and also in meningitis as treatment and as well in prophylaxis or in carrier. But it should not be used in other infections. Although it is effective in many of other infections, even upper respiratory tract infections, sometimes even pneumonia, but its use here should be restricted to these two uses to avoid resistance. Because in other diseases, we have many, many drugs to replace or be alternatives. But here in TB, alternatives are far, far less than in any bacterial infections elsewhere or by any other pathogen. Now, adverse effects of this rifampin. Being lipophilic, similar to INH, first of all, it can cause this liver damage or hepatic system and other green-colored adverse effects. That is also bone marrow depression. So these adverse effects are similar to INH adverse effects. The third one is opposite to INH. Instead of INH being enzyme inhibitor with possible toxicity when combined with other drugs, lipophilic in nature, this rifampin is oppositely enzyme inducer. And so it can antagonize many lipophilic drugs. And so in combination with other lipophilic drugs, the dose may be increased or other drugs can be alternatives. Otherwise, treatment will not be efficient. Fourthly, and very important, is that its metabolites are red in color. And so, almost all secretions of in patient receiving rifampicin are red. For example, red urine, red sweat secretions, and so on. Of course, this is not significant clinically in the disease process itself, but it may be very troubling and obnoxious to the patient. The patient usually thinks, unless previously knowing this from his physician or even pharmacist, that this red urine can indicate bleeding, which is not the case. So we must tell this, that is, this is due to red metabolite, it is not important, it is not blood, and nothing to deal with. The other two adverse effects, that is number 5 and number 6, are due to broad spectrum nature of rifampin, unlike, of course, INH. Superinfections mean secondary infection developed during treatment of another infection by broad-spectrum antibiotics. That to say, here a patient treated by TB or any other disease, for example. Now, the antibiotic will kill the pathogens, but the normal bacterial flora or fungi and so on are accustomed to our environment, body environment. They are not killed by this rifampin. They flourish and multiply, being freed from competition by pathogen. Because, as you know, non-pathogen, that is normal bacterial flora, live in balance with pathogenic bacteria. But this drug, there is balance in all things. Now, the pathogenic bacteria will be killed by antibiotics, rendering the non-pathogenic bacterial flora flourish and multiply and causing severe, possibly fatal infections by some bacteria, fungi, and so on. And this is called super infections, which is sometimes severe or even fatal. The second spectrum, caused also by the broad spectrum action, because the adverse effect brown, that is number 5 and number 6, are due to broad spectrum action of rifampin. This will be avitaminosis B and K. We know well that vitamin B and K are formed endogenously inside UIT by bacteria. Now, by killing of these bacteria, reduction of synthesis of both vitamins can occur. Decreased vitamin B for prolonged time, as I mentioned, can lead to polyneuropathy and other adverse effects. And vitamin K deficiency can lead to decreased prothrombin and consequently decreased prothrombin-dependent clotting factor, and bleeding may result. Similar to other antibiotics, hypersensitivity reactions can occur. And sometimes in some people only, flu or influenza-like manifestations can occur in large dose. That is, a picture very similar to influenza. That is fever, discharge, congestion, nasal congestion, lacrimal conjunctiva, congestion by lacrimal secretions, and so on, painful conditions anywhere. These manifestations may mask or may be very similar or simulate flu manifestations or influenza manifestation. So a patient treated by this drug, we are confused if getting these manifestations, either it is true influenza, true flu, or just adverse effects of rifampin. Now, unfortunately, resistance development by rifampicin is very rapid by mutation. So we can restrict its use in the aforementioned indications I mentioned. Now, dose is 600 milligram daily on morning, or similar to INH, sometimes we give the dose twice weekly in short courses, even and short courses up to 6 months. Of course, this is in some restricted cases under observation and follow-up, and many conditions must be fulfilled to achieve this short-term therapy. Thirdly, ethambutol. Its mechanism is to decrease TB, but by decreased polymerization of arabinoglycan, causing loss of integrity of tubercle bacilli cell wall. As well, it inhibits transfer of mycolic acid into cell wall, not to decrease mycolic essences as INH, but it inhibits transfer of this mycolic acid into cell wall, again disrupting or destroying cell barrier. Now, by destruction of this cell barrier, not only this is effective against tubercle bacilli, but rather it can cause more penetration by lipophilic anti-tubercular drugs, because these drugs first cross the TB wall and then brain, but by disruption of this wall, now we disrupt or destroy the first barrier against influx of these drugs into the tubercle bacilli, and so these drugs can pass easily inside the cell of TB, causing damage. But this thiamubutol is tuberculostatic. Unlike the previous three anti-tuberculous drugs, which were tuberculocidal. Now, similar to the previous two drugs, pharmacokinetics of the thiamubutol is dependent on its lipophilic nature. But differently, for some reasons, it has renal clearance. And so, its dose adjustment and precautions are on renal dysfunction rather than liver dysfunction. Uses of these drugs, by virtue of its mechanism to disrupt cell wall, is an additive drug to delay resistance to the other antitubercular drugs. Adverse effects. When mentioning adverse effect of these antitubercular drugs, I choose the most important and the most common and the most serious adverse effects. Because, of course, if you know adverse effects, there are many, many adverse effects, but many of them are not common, some are rare, some are not dangerous, and so to memorize, it is difficult, of course, to memorize tens of adverse effects by each drug. So I specify adverse effects which are important and severe, and precautions must guard against it. And in this drug, thiamubutol, it is eye damage, that is optic nerve damage due to retrobulbar neuritis. And so it is very dangerous to the eye, to visual acuity. So a patient treated by thiamubutol must have regular examination on fundus and retina. So fundus examination, retinal examination, is very important to guard against neuritis, optic nerve damage. Resistance occurs by mutation. The fourth antitubercular drug of first line is pyrazinamide, and is tuberculocidal. Pharmacokinetics is lipophilic. That is against most types of TB, as I mentioned before. So it is commonly combined with INH and rifampin. As I mentioned, first to start three drugs, and then they change one drug, withdraw one, and the alternative give other, add another, and so on, to reduce resistance, among other advantages of these anti-TB combinations I mentioned before. Being lipophilic, adverse effects include, number one, hepatotoxicity, but as well, GIT upset, nausea and vomiting can occur, and gout, hyperuricemia, as well as fever sometimes occur. So we should know these adverse effects, because these drugs, like other antitubercular drugs, are used for long-term therapy. Now the second line antitubercular drugs. These second line drugs are used in combination with one of first drugs if three conditions. First, resistance. Now, if there is no improvement, now I can consider the patient to be resistant to this drug, and I change this drug by a second line one. Failure also, or toxicity. That is why we should observe specific drug toxicity by each of these drugs, especially those I mentioned in detail, because the occurrence of these toxic effects can necessitate change by these drugs, other drugs. The first second line drug, the famous drug, streptomycin, mechanism. As you know from your chemotherapy study in general pharmacology that streptomycin is one of aminoglycosides. And these aminoglycosides act by dual mechanism, that is by inhibiting protein synthesis via binding with ribosomal subunit number 30, ribosomal subunit number S30, as well as changing cell membrane permeability, allowing sodium potassium influx and rupture of cell membrane. And so, in aminoglycoside mechanism in most of bacteria, they are bactericidal. Bactericidal, because they not only inhibit protein synthesis, and as you know, other drugs inhibiting protein synthesis are bacteriostatic, but aminoglycosides in particular are bactericidal, because not only they inhibit protein synthesis, but rather they cause malformed protein. They change the genetic code that is rendering malformed protein, which is lethal to the cell. In contrast to other drugs acting on protein synthesis, only stopping and delaying it. Now, in contrast to other bacteria, because as I mentioned, streptomycin, similar to other antimicrobials, is bactericidal, but specifically in TB due to multiple factor resistance and different structure and so on, it is only tuberculostatic. And this is very important, that streptomycin is bactericidal but tuberculostatic. Now, the spectrum is mainly regarding uses in TB, but is effective as other aminoglycosides are negative. Again, it's mainly negative bacilli, as you know, and positive cocci. That's why you know that aminoglycosides are commonly used in combination with penicillin, because penicillin has opposite spectrum. Penicillin are mainly against positive cocci and to less extent ampicillin and other penicillin against negative bacilli and so on. And so they are maybe combined. But streptomycin, being also effective against these negative bacilli and positive cocci, is not in common use because other antimicrobials can be preferred. And to restrict its use here, or concisely to use these drugs mainly in TB. Pharmacokinetics, this is lipophobic. So unlike the previous drugs, lipophilic, this is lipophobic drug that is not absorbed orally, that cannot cross membrane. So this streptomycin is given by injection, intramuscular injection, not orally, because lipophobic. That is opposite to other lipophilic drugs I mentioned before. It does not pass blood-brain barrier. So it is ineffective in treatment of meningitis. Next, it cannot enter liver cell, so it is not metabolized in liver, and so it is excreted in kidney as changed, as unchanged, because it is not metabolized. That is excreted changed as it is, not changed because it is not metabolized by liver. Accordingly, adverse effects should be restricted here or mainly to the kidney, not liver, unlike other drugs. So the main adverse effects of aminoglycosides, including streptomycin, is nephrotoxicity, as well as ototoxicity. It has other far, far less important adverse effects, but rather the most important adverse effects of streptomycin, especially on long-term therapy, is dual. Nephrotoxicity, very important, renal damage, and ototoxicity, that is vertigo, tinnitus, deafness, and so on. So, dose of this drug, accordingly, is changed according to renal function, not liver, compared to other drugs, because it is renal dependent. And so, uses of these drugs, being lipophobic, is restricted to open types because it cannot pass membranes and fibrous tissue, closed lesion, caseous lesions, and so on. And it's restricted to extracellular, but not intracellular bacilli. And because it is present as such in the urinary tract, being unchanged, that's lipophobic, it is effective against urinary tract infection by TB. Far more than other drugs, of course. The second generation anti-TB drug is ethionamide. The most important adverse effects of these drugs are gastric irritations. So it is not used for these patients with, for example, gastritis, peptic ulcer, concomitant use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, patients with blood group O, and so on, are less likely to use these drugs. The second adverse effect is neurological manifestations, and this is treated by dioxin or vitamin B6, and also hepatotoxicity. The third drug is amikacin and capreomycin as members of aminoglycosides similar to streptomycin. But these are relative newer drugs with higher efficacy and less resistance compared to streptomycin. But they should not be used for long-term therapy, especially in elderly people. Because in elderly people, there is much danger, ototoxicity, and nephrotoxicity. The fourth adverse effect, the fourth drug is cyclosurine. Cyclosurine is specific for TB, but with marked CNS and common CNS toxicity in up to 1/4 of patients, that is 25%. And as many other anti-tuberculous drugs, CNS toxicity may be decreased or minimized by co-administration of pyridoxine. Now, the other drugs, fifth and sixth drugs, as second-line TB are quinolones and rifampicin analogs. Now, quinolones. Quinolones, as you know, include many groups. And nowadays, these groups, because some of them are against negative bacilli, others against positive cocci as well, and even in some forms which are not treated by other antibiotics, quinolones are very commonly used in many clinical situations in chemotherapy. But here, we should not use any quinolone. We restrict here in TB those quinolones which are more potent with specific anti-tuberculous activity. These are the very common drug ciprofloxacin, very commonly used and is from years and years, and also levofloxacin. It was introduced after, but I mentioned that it has more spectrum of activity. I discuss it in details in respiratory tract infection because this is a very famous drug nowadays. And the third quinolone preparation is moxifloxacin. And this is preferred. And I mentioned the difference between these three drugs in the quinolone groups. And we should know every advantage of these drugs to properly use these drugs. Sixthly, as I mentioned, rifampicin was wrongly used by many bacterial diseases for tens of years, even many years ago. And so resistance developed to it in many, many cases because of use in, for example, pharyngitis, respiratory tract infection, and so on. So alternatively, other newer analogs to rifampicin have been introduced. These are rifabutin and rifapentine. These drugs are preferred to rifampicin because of low incidence of resistance. Now, the previous drugs I mentioned, are used mainly in treatment with the various schedules, and these schedules are different from country to another, from even black, unlike the white people, also according to the state of the patients and the site of tuberculosis, either in lung, biliary TB, meningitis, open lesion, and so on, and according also to the age of the patients. Now we have so different schedules and different courses, and this is in treatment. Moreover, in prophylaxis, different schedules are now introduced and they are rapidly changed. So we can find a research saying that for these drugs, in combination with these drugs, can be used for example, the period so and so. And another research saying completely different drugs and another schedules, differing in doses, differing in drug frequency, and so on. And I think you can study this in other branches, in respiratory module, in TILS, of course, and so I'm not going to repeat this. But very important to discriminate between these drugs, because these drugs are long-term used. Thank you.